Let's talk about reactions of ethers, both their formation and eventual cleavage. So if our desire is to form a symmetrical ether, such as the one we see here, diethyl ether, we can do so from a primary alcohol in acid. So we put a few drops of sulfuric acid in and heat the reaction, and what we'll get is protonation mechanistically here from sulfuric acid, because our solvent is the ether that we're trying, or is the alcohol that we're trying to react to form the ether, and we'll protonate and create a good leaving group in equilibrium conditions, heated acid here, from our sulfuric acid on our primary carbon, and then another solvent alcohol can come in and attack, can attack the carbon with the good leaving group water there, kicking off the water to form our ether. And so it would still be protonated, so we'd have to remember to take another solvent ethanol molecule to wrap up this mechanism here, grabbing the proton, lone pair goes back on to oxygen to get our ether. The problem is we're heating this, we're going to have an E2 competition that's going to form here if you'll permit me to do this side reaction. So we've got our solvent ethanol again, and now it can grab here and then kick off a stable alcohol, forming our E2 product here, which can bubble off as a gas if we're heating. And so we need to have this system sealed to prevent Le Chatelier's principle from taking over, and let it form an equilibrium amount, quench the reaction, and then we could separate our products by distillation. So it's not the best reaction in the world, but it can get you a decent yield if we're again using primary alcohol. So let's look at a better way. The Williamson ether synthesis will take a strong nucleophile to a primary or secondary alkyl halide, because we are looking at SN2 conditions. And because of that, we want our nucleophile to be more bulky than the electrophile, so that our SN2 reaction, one of our lone pairs here, can attack our carbon, primary or secondary carbon, and create our ether in SN2 conditions. Very high stability of our final product ether, because again, we are not in acid conditions, we're in more of kinetic conditions in the Williamson ether synthesis. We've got more control. So let's look at a couple of examples. We could have a tertiary ether attack a methyl or primary position, and we would create our product here, the ether that we see on the right. And the point here is we don't want to instead use the alkyl halide on the more bulky carbon and then do the alkoxide on the less, on the methyl side, because now we're going to get an E2 competition. In fact, exclusively E2 because of that tertiary halide. So we're paying attention here to make sure that we are using the more bulky nucleophile and the less bulky electrophile. This also works very well for secondary versus primary methyl, so sodium isopropoxide. Looking back at the previous, just to point out, this is potassium T-butoxide. Normally, it's sold in that salt form. We want to use the identical solvent here, T-butanol, so that we match our protons, so that we don't get proton exchange of our solvent. We don't want to use methanol, because we could proton exchange with T-butoxide to make methoxide, so we want to pay attention to the solvent as well. So isopropoxide, generally packaged as the sodium isomer, or excuse me, the sodium salt, sodium isopropoxide reacting with the primary or methyl halide SN2, and we get our ether product that we see here. Okay, and again, we don't want to do the more bulky electrophile and less bulky nucleophile, because now we've got a secondary halide, and that's going to favor E2 more strongly. We're going to get a mixture of products, but E2 will be our major product in this situation. Now, suppose we have a tertiary versus a secondary. This is not the best because we're always going to get E2 competition, and the E2 is probably going to win. And so, yes, we could get a small amount of our desired product. Again, these are kind of weird ethers anyway. It's not something that we generally want to make anyway, but we would get a minor product in this situation. So, and then the major would actually be an E2, where we'd pull off the beta hydrogen and kick off the iodide leaving group in that situation. Okay, so what if we want to take these ethers apart instead of form them? Ethers are very good solvents because they are unreactive to most reagents. And so the only thing we can really do to them is we can take them apart in the presence of HBr, hydrobromic and hydroiodic acid. Tertiary halides are going to form most readily when we have a primary or methyl on the other side. And so if we have these two, the tertiary halide is going to come from this side. The primary is coming from this side. And so what do we get? Well, we get E1 or SN1 type substitution where we protonate our ether. And then we get the SN1 type elimination here to form our carbocation. Again, this is equilibrium conditions because we're in hot refluxing acid. And so we'll end up getting an alcohol, methanol on this side, our carbocation intermediate, and then the bromide that's floating around here can add back to this position, giving us our tertiary bromide and primary or methanol here as our two products. Okay, so we'd substitute the tertiary position most likely because tertiaries will more swiftly form the carbocation intermediate. A methyl halide is going to form more readily versus a primary halide. So our products here are going to be ethanol and methyl iodide because from our protonated ether in the presence of acid, now we've got an SN2 mechanism that is most active, and so the less hindered position is going to be what gives us our final products here, methyl iodide and ethanol. So again, methyl halides more readily versus primary. But then we have the last scenario where secondary halides could pair with secondary, primary, or tertiary, and we really don't see a very good trend. We're going to see a mix of products that can occur. And so what we'll see is the secondary will get its iodide, but it will also take the alcohol side. The primary side will get an iodide, but we'll also get an alcohol over here as well. So we've got a couple of different mechanisms in play because there's not a big difference between the secondary stability and the primary and tertiary. So it's kind of a middle ground. We'll see a mixture of products with that cleavage reaction. So not the best in the world if we're after a single product. One additional factor is that if we have an excess of halide, no matter what ether cleavage reaction we're going to do, we can convert everything to an alkyl halide. So with our initial reaction here with the acid, we'll protonate like we showed a minute ago to get our leaving group primed. And with this one, it's a tertiary versus a primary. So we said above, our initial deal here is going to be to form the carbocation. Well, if we do that, we're going to get our SN1 reaction where our iodide then adds back to that position. And we get our tertiary iodide, our tert-butyl iodide. But don't forget, we just formed a primary alcohol that in excess acid can also protonate from that excess acid and then undergo another SN2 reaction with the excess iodide. So we get SN1 first, But then we get with the primary, we get SN2, and we end up with an iodide in both ends of the ether. So we get an iodide from the primary side by the excess. We get initially an iodide via the T-butyl side via SN1. And other interesting ethers we could have that will cleave under acidic conditions are aryl ethers. And with aryl ethers, we always get phenol on one side, because if we protonate our starting ether, there's no way for it to form a cation, because it would be an sp2 carbon makes a very unstable carbocation, a vinyl type cation, which is very unstable, so that's not going to happen. There's no primary or secondary carbon here for us to do an SN2 onto, so that side's going to be unreactive to a nucleophile. Instead, what we would get is iodide substitution on the other side of our ether. No matter what we have, we're always going to get the alkyl iodide versus the phenol side, and that always would form. Suppose we had a vinyl ether, we would again protonate via an acid-base reaction, and we've got the same situation. SN1 would not be favored because we can't form the vinyl carbocation. So what we end up getting is a bromide attack on the methyl side here, and we end up with our methyl bromide, but we end up with a very interesting enol, which would tautomerize to the aldehyde on the other side. So we can get a couple of different functional groups out of a vinyl ether.